This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: History of Electric Light. Author: Henry Schroeder. Year: 1923. Foreword. In the year 1884, a section of transportation was organized in the United States National Museum for the purpose of preparing and assembling educational exhibits of a few objects of railroad machinery which had been obtained both from the Centennial Exhibition held in Philadelphia in 1876 and still earlier as incidentals to ethnological collections, and to secure other collections relating to the railway industry. From this beginning, the section was expanded to include the whole field of engineering and is designated at present as the Divisions of Mineral and Mechanical Technology. The growth and enlargement of the collections has been particularly marked in the fields of mining and mineral industries. Mechanical engineering, especially pertaining to the steam engine, internal combustion engine and locomotive, naval architecture and electrical engineering, particularly the development of the telegraph, telephone and the electric light. In the acquisition of objects visualizing the history of electric light, the museum has been rather fortunate, particularly as regards the developments in the United States. Thus, mention may be made of the original patent office models of the more important dynamos, arc lights, and incandescent lights, together with original commercial apparatus after these models. A unit of the equipment used in the first commercially successful installation on land of an incandescent lighting system, presented by Joseph E. Hines, in whose engraving establishment in New York City the installation was made in 1881, and a large series of incandescent lights, mainly originals, visualizing chronologically the developments of the Edison light from its inception, presented at intervals since the year 1898 by the General Electric Company. The object of all collections in the divisions is to visualize broadly the steps by which advances have been made in each field of engineering, to show the layman the fundamental and general principles which are the basis for the developments, and to familiarize the engineer with branches of engineering other than his own. Normally, when a subject is completely covered by a collection of objects, a paper is prepared and published describing the collection and the story it portrays. In the present instance, however, on account of the uncertainty of the time of completing the collection, if it is possible ever to bring this about, it was thought advisable to publish Mr. Schroeder's paper, which draws upon the museum collection, as completely as possible. Carl W. Mittman, Curator, Divisions of Mineral and Mechanical Technology, U.S. National Museum. Topic: Early Records of Electricity and Magnetism. About 25 centuries ago, Thales, a Greek philosopher, recorded the fact that if amber is rubbed, it will attract light objects. The Greeks called amber electron, from which we get the word electricity. About 250 years later, Aristotle, another Greek philosopher, mentioned that the lodestone would attract iron. Lodestone is an iron ore, Fe3O4, having magnetic qualities and is now called magnetite. The word magnet comes from the fact that the best specimens of lodestones came from Magnesia, a city in Asia Minor. Plutarch, a Greek biographer, wrote about 100 AD that iron is sometimes attracted and at other times repelled by a lodestone. This indicates that the piece of iron was magnetized by the lodestone. In 1180, Alexander Neckam, an English monk, described the compass, which probably had been invented by sailors of the northern countries of Europe, although its invention has been credited to the Chinese. Early compasses probably consisted of an iron needle, magnetized by a lodestone, mounted on a piece of wood floating in water. The word lodestone or leading stone comes from the fact that it would point towards the north if suspended like a compass. William Gilbert, physician to Queen Elizabeth of England, wrote a book about the year 1600, giving all the information then known on the subject. He also described his experiments, showing, among other things, the existence of magnetic lines of force and of north and south poles in a magnet. Robert Norman had discovered a few years previously that a compass needle mounted on a horizontal axis would dip downward. Gilbert cut a large lodestone into a sphere and observed that the needle did not dip at the equator of this sphere, the dip increasing to 90 degrees as the poles were approached. From this he deduced that the Earth was a magnet with the magnetic North Pole at the geographic North Pole. It has since been determined that these two poles do not coincide. Gilbert suggested the use of the dipping needle to determine latitude. He also discovered that other substances beside amber would attract light objects if rubbed. Topic: Machines generating electricity by friction. Otto von Guericke was mayor of the city of Magdeburg as well as a philosopher. About 1650, he made a machine consisting of a ball of sulfur mounted on a shaft which could be rotated. Electricity was generated when the hand was pressed against the globe as it rotated. He also discovered that electricity could be conducted away from the globe by a chain and would appear at the other end of the chain. Von Guericke also invented the vacuum air pump. In 1709, Francis Hauksbee, an Englishman, made a similar machine using a hollow glass globe which could be exhausted. The exhausted globe, when rotated at high speed and rubbed by hand, would produce a glowing light. This electric light, as it was called, created great excitement when it was shown before the Royal Society, a gathering of scientists in London. Otto von Guericke's electric machine, 1650. A ball of sulfur was rotated, electricity being generated when it rubbed against the hand. Stephen Gray, 20 years later, showed the Royal Society that electricity could be conducted about 1,000 feet by a hemp thread, supported by silk threads. If metal supports were used, this could not be done. Charles Dufay, a Frenchman, repeated Gray's experiments and showed in 1733 that the substances which were insulators and which Gilbert had discovered would become electrified if rubbed. Those substances which Gilbert could not electrify were conductors of electricity. Topic: The Leyden jar. The thought came to von Kleist, Bishop of Pomerania, Germany, about 1745, that electricity could be stored. The frictional machines generated so small an amount of electricity, though, as is now known, at a very high pressure, several thousand volts, that he thought he could increase the quantity by storing it. Knowing that glass was an insulator and water a conductor, he filled a glass bottle partly full of water with a nail in the cork to connect the machine with the water. Holding the bottle in one hand and turning the machine with the other for a few minutes, he then disconnected the bottle from the machine. When he touched the nail with his other hand, he received a shock which nearly stunned him. This was called the Leyden jar, the forerunner of the present condenser. It received its name from the fact that its discovery was also made a short time after by experimenters in the University of Leyden. Further experiments showed that the hand holding the bottle was as essential as the water inside, so these were substituted by tin foil coatings inside and outside the bottle. Benjamin Franklin, American statesman, scientist, and printer, made numerous experiments with the Leyden jar. He connected several jars in parallel, as he called it, which gave a discharge strong enough to kill a turkey. He also connected the jars in series, or in cascade, as he called it, thus establishing the principle of parallel and series connections. Noticing the similarity between the electric spark and lightning, Franklin in 1752 performed his famous kite experiment. Flying a kite in a thunderstorm, he drew electricity from the clouds to charge Leyden jars, which were later discharged, proving that lightning and electricity were the same. This led him to invent the lightning rod. Topic: Electricity generated by chemical means. Luigi Galvani was an Italian scientist. About 1785, so the story goes, his wife was in delicate health and some frog legs were being skinned to make her a nourishing soup. An assistant, holding the legs with a metal clamp and cutting the skin with a scalpel, happened to let the clamp and scalpel touch each other. To his amazement, the frog legs twitched. Galvani repeated the experiment many times by touching the nerve with a metal rod and the muscle with a different metal rod and allowing the rods to touch, and propounded the theory of animal electricity in a paper he published in 1791. Alessandro Volta, a professor of physics in the University of Pavia, Italy, read about Galvani's work and repeated his experiments. He found that the extent of the movement of the frog legs depended on the metals used for the rods, and thus believed that the electric charge was produced by the contact of dissimilar metals with the moisture in the muscles. To prove his point, he made a pile of silver and zinc discs with cloths wet with salt water between them. This was in 1799, and he described his pile in March 1800 in a letter to the Royal Society in London. Voltaic pile, 1799. Volta discovered that electricity could be generated by chemical means and made a pile of silver and zinc discs with cloths wet with salt water between them. This was the forerunner of the present-day dry battery. Photograph courtesy Professor Chaz. F. Chandler Museum, Columbia University, New York. This was an epic-making discovery, as it was the forerunner of the present-day primary battery. Volta soon found that the generation of electricity became weaker as the cloths became dry, so to overcome this he made his crown of cups. This consisted of a series of cups containing salt water in which strips of silver and zinc were dipped. Each strip of silver in one cup was connected to the zinc strip in the next cup, the end strips of silver and zinc being terminals of the battery. This was the first time that a continuous supply of electricity in reasonable quantities was made available, so the volt, the unit of electrical pressure, was named in his honor. It was later shown that the chemical affinity of one of the metals in the liquid was converted into electric energy. The chemical action of Volta's battery is that the salt water attacks the zinc when the circuit is closed, forming zinc chloride, caustic soda, and hydrogen gas. The chemical equation is Zn plus 2 sodium chloride plus 2 H2O equals zinc chloride plus 2 NaOH plus H2. Topic: Improvement of Volta's battery. It was early suggested that sheets of silver and zinc be soldered together back to back, and that a trough be divided into cells by these bimetal sheets being put into grooves cut in the sides and bottom of the trough. This is the reason why one unit of a battery is called a cell. It was soon found that a more powerful cell could be made if copper, zinc, and dilute sulfuric acid were used. The zinc is dissolved by the acid forming zinc sulfate and hydrogen gas, thus Zn plus hydrogen sulfate equals zinc sulfate plus H2. The hydrogen gas appears as bubbles on the copper and reduces the open circuit voltage, about 0.8 volt per cell, as current is taken from the battery. This is called polarization. Owing to minute impurities in the zinc, it is attacked by the acid even when no current is taken from the battery, the impurities forming with the zinc a short-circuited local cell. This is called local action, and this difficulty was at first overcome by removing the zinc from the acid when the battery was not in use. Topic: Davy's discoveries. Sir Humphry Davy was a well-known English chemist, and with the aid of powerful batteries constructed for the Royal Institution in London, he made numerous experiments on the chemical effects of electricity. He decomposed a number of substances and discovered the elements boron, potassium, and sodium. He heated strips of various metals to incandescence by passing current through them, and showed that platinum would stay incandescent for some time without oxidizing. This was about 1802. In the early frictional machines, the presence of electricity was shown by the fact that sparks could be obtained. Similarly, the breaking of the circuit of a battery would give a spark. Davy, about 1809, demonstrated that this spark could be maintained for a long time with the large battery of 2,000 cells he had constructed. Using two sticks of charcoal connected by wires to the terminals of this very powerful battery, he demonstrated before the Royal Society the light produced by touching the sticks together and then holding them apart horizontally about 3 inches. The brilliant flame obtained he called an arc because of its arch shape, the heated gases rising assuming this form. Davy was given the degree of LL.D. for his distinguished research work and was knighted on the eve of his marriage, April 11, 1812. Topic: Researches of Oersted, Ampère, Schweiger, and Sturgeon. Hans Christian Oersted was a professor of physics at the University of Copenhagen in Denmark. One day in 1819, while addressing his students, he happened to hold a wire through which current was flowing over a large compass. To his surprise, he saw the compass was deflected from its true position. He promptly made a number of experiments and discovered that, by reversing the current, the compass was deflected in the opposite direction. Oersted announced his discovery in 1820. André Marie Ampère was a professor of mathematics in the École Polytechnique in Paris. Hearing of Oersted's discovery, he immediately made some experiments and made the further discovery in 1820 that if the wire is coiled and current passed through it, the coil had all the properties of a magnet. These two discoveries led to the invention of Schweiger in 1820, of the galvanometer, or multiplier as it was then called, a very sensitive instrument for measuring electric currents. It consisted of a delicate compass needle suspended in a coil of many turns.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.